Part 2 of optometry boards can seem tricky to study for because, unlike most of your other tests, you're dealing with cases on cases on cases. How do you prepare for that? Let's break it down. Welcome back! It's Dr. Andreas here with another video. If you're a new viewer, my goal here is helping optometry students, residents, and new doctors with optometry-related questions. If you like the video, please consider hitting that like button below and subscribing to the channel. And now, on to the video. Quick disclaimer, I know nothing of what will be on boards. I have no insider knowledge, and these are just some tips collected after months of studying for boards, followed by reflecting on that experience, as well as talking to students ever since. And before I begin, I'm disclosing my NBEO Part 2 score from December 2018. That one took some major grinding as well, but like you'll find out, your hard work will be so worth it, not just to further your career, but to greatly impact the lives of your patients. Just wait until you find the tiniest vertical prism or simply some uncorrected plus that relieves the patient of their headaches that they've been dealing with for months. Or just wait until you see your first retinal embolus, which will result in your patient being sent for an ultrasound, which will reveal a clogged artery, which will then lead them to have the proper treatment, which will then lead them to not having a stroke in the future. Congratulations, you just saved the patient's life. My point is, Part 2 is an opportunity to combine your knowledge from Part 1 with your clinical thinking to crush every case on this test, finalizing your training as an awesome doctor. When do I start Part 2? Like with Part 1, August was when I personally started, but as late as end of September should be fine. You can still start later, but keep in mind, the later you start, the more you're at risk of cramming, which is not ideal. Now, the timing of when to start gets complicated if you're taking Part 3 before Part 2. I would reserve like 2 weeks or so to practice Part 3, which means two less weeks of Part 2 studying that you have to account for. For Part 3 tips, check out the first video I made that I'll tag above. When I prepared for Part 2, you won't be shocked to hear that I probably spent at least 90% of my study time using KMK, whether it's the book, the video, the image gallery, Optometry Pro, practice cases, crash course, and so on. My stance on OptoPrep is the same as before. Not necessary, but it's nice if you feel like you need more cases to practice with. Personally, I didn't feel like it helped me that much in Part 1 because KMK has so many resources, so I didn't bother to pay for Part 2 of OptoPrep this time. With that said, do your own research, ask your friends and upperclassmen that you know, as I'm sure some will disagree with me, and make your own decision. Now, as for actual planning, the fun part, I decided to make it a little bit simpler because you only have less than half the amount of material to study for compared to Part 1. Plus, at this point, you're probably so tired of board prep and want to just keep it simple. A good starting point is to go to your online KMK account and read the overview PDF that is available to you that addresses what to do. Personally, I modified that plan for what's realistic for me. For example, I'm a slow reader, so I allocated more time to reading the book and came up with this. First step is August 1st, or whenever you start, until November 1st, you should read the book and watch the videos. The other 5 weeks is just stretching and preparing for the actual test. KMK offers 3 full case tests, 3 mini case tests, 3 TMOT tests, and 1 special test on pharmacology, which was written by pharmacology legend Dr. Bartlett. I would take that one as well. Then you have optional stuff you can sprinkle in throughout your study schedule as needed, which we'll talk about. Okay, let's go through this plan piece by piece. Your plan for reading and watching may need to be slightly different than when you took Part 1, because you're done just passively learning. Part 2 is essentially applying Part 1 to cases, and the videos are going over the cases with some good tips sprinkled in. So a good strategy you could implement that I personally did was this. Read each case as if you're taking the test. Answer the questions, grade yourself, see what you got right or wrong, then watch the video on that case and read the answer explanations in more detail. So let's say I just started today, right? I'd open the book to case one, and then I'd read it as if I'm taking boards, and I might time myself. I'll answer the questions, stop the timer, see how I did, then watch the video on case one. After I'm done, I can take the time to read the answer explanations in more detail to fill in some of the gaps. Then I can move on to case two. Time myself, read the case, answer the questions, and so on. This is a great strategy because as you're studying the book and videos, you're already practicing the skills needed to skim through a case, look at the questions, and then derive the information from the case in a timely manner. When I first started, I was probably taking like 7 to 9 minutes reading the case and answering the questions, but by like case 20, I was already doing them in 4 to 6 minutes, which is more appropriate for a timed test like that. And then by the time you're taking full case or mini case tests at the end of your reading, you're already acclimated and efficient in taking that kind of test. And you'll learn pretty quickly that finishing cases is a skill on its own. You'll get better at scanning data and only focusing on what may seem relevant. For example, you may have a case in KMK or OptoPrep that talks about a patient with, let's say, blurry vision who presents with a high ESO but poor positive fusional variances, and then with retinoscopy refraction and wet refraction not being consistent with each other. So all that makes you think hard for why this patient seemed blurry, what's going on here. But then you look at the end of the case and the patient has obvious diabetic macular edema. And then you get asked questions that are related to that edema, which doesn't sound too bad, but if you just sat there and read every word of that case, you would have wasted your time analyzing all that BV data. So it's generally a good idea to just quickly skim through a case, look at the picture if there is one, then go back to the questions, and from there, go back to the case. It's kind of like when you have to take the reading section of the SAT or the OAT, where you're supposed to scan through that really long passage, get to the questions, and then refer back. Also realize that as it was in part one, the book and videos are going to be the most time-consuming part of your study plan, so try to get that done ASAP. If you have trouble motivating yourself, here's a tool you can use. Here is the Excel sheet that I made for the 2018-2019 edition of the Part 2 KMK book. I'll link in the description below. The table of contents may have slightly changed since, but to the left are the chapters from the book, and to the right you'll see white boxes. Every box was worth 10 pages. For example, Lids, Lashes, Lacrimal Orbit is chapter 1, has 4 cases and 22 pages, so I have 2 boxes there. When I would finish reading 10 pages, I would pencil in that box that I completed it. Keep in mind, 10 pages of part 2 material will likely take you less time than it did for part 1 because each case alone is like 2-3 pages before you even get to the questions. Penciling the boxes kept me motivated, as the more boxes I filled, the more I could visualize my progress and want to do more. And I did the same to the videos. I made similar blue boxes to the far right, and each one is worth 30 minutes. This Excel sheet is something you could do if you like to visualize your progress. By the way, just a friendly reminder to comment below with any questions you may have so far, and also maybe hit the like button. So you're done with the book and videos, let's move on to the second part of your study plan. These are mostly self-explanatory. The full case tests are composed of a few full cases, which by the way are no joke, and that's why they should be taken after you built your foundation and gotten efficient at completing cases while you were reading the book. But the cases are very helpful and are diverse between disease, optics, binocular vision, etc. I would reserve a day to just taking one of these full case tests and then going over every single question, even the ones you got right. That's how you're going to get the most out of them. You want to know why your answer is the right answer and why the wrong ones are wrong. All of this should take you a few hours, so that's why I prefer to only assign one full case test per day. In contrast, the mini case test and TMOD test are a lot shorter, so you could probably allocate a day to taking a mini case test and a TMOD test and still probably be able to fit in some other stuff. Basically, it should only take you about 7 days collectively to do all the full case, mini case, TMOD, and Bartlett test. Spread that out over the month of November and you got yourself some good practice. Supplemental stuff. KMK Image Gallery on Instagram, awesome. As of August of 2020, there are over 450 high-quality pictures, which can help build some good passive practice. You could be scrolling through a few of those on Instagram while in clinic on a slow day, or if you're on the bus. KMK Optometry Pro on Instagram is also awesome. There are some very cool cases there presented by Dr. Braffman and Dr. Hammond, who both did an ocular disease residency at Bascom Palmer. Crash Course. Like in part one, the Crash Course is designed as a form of rapid Q&A, giving you a quick review of a large amount of content in a short amount of time. I definitely recommend this. Kyle will pull up some awesome pictures of conditions and then ask you a question about them. Very helpful, especially when he pulls up rare photos of things like corneal dystrophies, retinal dystrophies, and conditions like Terrien's or SLK. The more conditions you're visually familiar with, the less chance you'll see a random picture of a diseased retina eye on boards and be like, what? Of course, your goal for the last few days before you take boards is to rest up, try to get a good night's sleep 2 nights before boards, since we know that the night before boards, you may be too anxious to sleep. In my part one video, I talked about my bad experience the night before boards, which led me to not sleep at all. So this time, I was so worried I wouldn't sleep that I took NyQuil at like 6 p.m. I was out cold by 9. I'm not recommending this in any way, I'm just saying that's what I did, and I woke up feeling pretty good. But you do what you think is going to set you up best for a relaxing sleep. If I could go back, I'd probably watch an ASMR video on YouTube instead. Those videos are weird, but they work.
Welcome back to Relaxing Before NBEO Part 2. This video is proudly sponsored by Andreas KMK.
Oof, did you feel that? And that's my recommended plan. Remember, if you're not set on studying in August or September, at least make your study plan, then so you're on the right track. Then ask yourself the following questions when you're assessing how realistic your study plan is. I went into detail on this in my part one video, but this time I'll just list them here. Pause the video if you haven't read them yet. So there you have it, guys. My NBEO part two tips. If there's a question you have that I didn't answer, please comment that below. That way everyone sees it and can benefit from it. And you're also helping my video move up the YouTube algorithm ladder by doing so. If you have any questions of preparing for part one or part three, you can watch my videos on them, which by the way, I've put all my NBEO videos on a playlist for your enjoyment. Remember, if you like the video, please hit the like button and consider subscribing. I'll see you next time.